We are in Windy Impenetrable National Park, one of the last sanctuaries of the mountain gorilla. Guided by rangers, we hike for hours through a rainy jungle with steep inclines. At last, we reach the gorillas. All gorillas live in the jungles of equatorial Africa. Their two species are divided into four subspecies, which are in turn made up of a variety of groups. In the jungles of Uganda, Rwanda, and the Democratic Republic of Congo, there are mountain gorillas and eastern lowland gorillas. While in western Africa, in a jungle that is shared by eight different countries, there are cross-river gorillas and western lowland gorillas. In spite of being spread over a wide area, all of these subspecies are endangered. And the mountain gorillas, like the ones here in Windy, have been driven to the brink of extinction. They are the most threatened of the four great ape species. A powerful male descends his tree and walks in front of us. Despite their impressive appearance, gorillas are peaceful animals, as long as basic protocol is followed. Five of the 30 groups that live here in the mountains of Windy have been habituated to the presence of humans, a total of 76 individuals that are a source of significant tourist income for the park. The apparent aggression of this silverback male is actually the start of a rapid courtship. Although, obviously, a courtship with a gorilla's touch. There are about 340 individuals left in the park, half of the total population of mountain gorillas. Here, the gorilla population seems to have stabilized at last, thanks to tourism and the peace that has settled over the country following a tragic past. The relative accessibility of the mountain gorillas of Uganda seems like child's play when compared to a search for western lowland gorillas. Max is one of the scientists working on the Mondika Gorilla Project. He and his pygmy assistants have led us into the jungles of the Congo. This time, we are also accompanied by Gabriela Ruiz, an expert gorilla guide. We are tracking the only habituated group of lowland gorillas in the Republic of Congo. Getting to Mondika, where Kingo and his family live, is quite an adventure. At last, our guide gives the signal. We have reached the gorillas. A baby emerges from the shadows. Max tells us to put on our masks. Germs from our world are a threat in this isolated jungle. Even the slightest cold could wipe out an entire group of gorillas. The baby is not alone. A warning grunt tells us that Kingo, the silverback male, is watching over his family from a short distance away. This is a real achievement for the future of ecotourism in the area. For tourists to come here, attracted by the possibility of getting up close to the gorillas, a lot of preparatory work is necessary. It takes years of following a group of gorillas before they are truly used to the presence of humans.
Once you start following one group continuously, then the habituation process starts, and you start contacting the group every day. But gorillas go through these phases, these stages in habituation. So the first one, normally they're a little bit curious about us, like, who's that? The second stage is they get a little bit frightened because we're following them all the time. And then after that, there comes a period, unfortunately, where they try to be aggressive in order to get rid of us. After that aggressive period, they finally start calming down and ignoring us. But this process can take maybe 4 or 5 years.
The first person to habituate different groups of lowland gorillas to the presence of humans, following long years of hard work, was Spanish primatologist Magdalena Bermejo. She carried out her work in the Losi Gorilla Sanctuary in Congo.
It was the first area where lowland gorillas were successfully habituated. In 1996, we began to cater to tourists, and the truth is, it worked really well in every way. Not only because the animals were highly visible, but also because the lowland forests make for a kind of observation of these jungle animals that is different from our usual concept of mountain gorillas. It's much harder to observe this kind of gorilla in the jungle. Even experienced trackers have a hard time seeing their tracks. It's really hard going. But with mountain gorillas, even I can follow their tracks. It's much easier to track them. So we noticed that this was a new, really interesting tourism product, that it sort of encourages the public at large to come watch in the jungle, in this kind of jungle, where at first it is hard to see, but where, with the help of an excellent tracker, you can discover a whole new world.
Tragically, all of those gorillas died shortly after being habituated by Magdalena Bermejo. They were the victims of a terrible assassin that lurks in the jungles of equatorial Africa, the Ebola virus. Of the 2,000 gorillas in the sanctuary where Bermejo worked, only 50 survived.
What is quite interesting now is to see how all the other variables in the area are behaving in a manner that will keep the surviving gorillas who have remained in the zone from disappearing entirely. We are watching how this population is recovering in these areas. That's a study we've been conducting over the past 4 years. We'd like to be optimistic, but what our findings are really showing is that if any extra variables are added in those zones, like poaching, the effects could be devastating. We might be talking about extinction in that case.
Following the loss of Bermejo's gorillas, Kingo's group, near Ndoki National Park, became the only group that would tolerate the presence of humans. Even so, we have to make continuous clicking noises to remind Kingo that we mean no harm. Our best effort at avoiding an uncomfortable situation. Of course, in the heart of the jungle, discomfort isn't necessarily the gorilla's fault. Millions of tiny bees, which locals called mujerons, are attracted by the salts in our sweat and swarm around us. We try to get used to it. After all, it's the price we have to pay for enjoying the company of this gorilla family.